fundamental books of Epicurus. Principal Doctrines, Vatican Sayings, and Letters. Book 2, Vatican Sayings. 1. A happy and eternal being has no trouble himself and brings no trouble upon any other being. Hence he is exempt from movements of anger and partiality, for every such movement implies weakness too. Death is nothing to us. For the body, when it has been resolved into its elements, has no feeling, and that which has no feeling is nothing to us. 3. Continuous pain does not last long in the body. On the contrary, pain, if extreme, is present a short time, and even that degree of pain which barely outweighs pleasure in the body does not last for many days together. Illnesses of long duration even permit of an excess of pleasure over pain in the body. 4. Every pain is easy to dismiss, because the most intense lasts only a few seconds, while the most prolonged bodily pains are mild. 5. It is impossible to live a pleasant life without living wisely and well and justly, and it is impossible to live wisely and well and justly without living pleasantly. Whenever any one of these is lacking, when, for instance, the person is not able to live wisely, though he lives well and justly, it is impossible for him to live a pleasant life. 6. It is impossible for the person who secretly violates any article of the social compact to feel confident that he will remain undiscovered, even if he has already escaped 10,000 times. For right on to the end of his life he is never sure he will not be detected. 7. For an aggressor to be undetected is hard. And for him to be confident that his concealment will continue is impossible. 8. Nature's wealth at once has its bounds and is easy to procure. But the wealth of vain fancies recedes to an infinite distance. 9. Necessity is an evil. However, there is no necessity to continue to live with necessity. 10. Remember that you are mortal and have a finite amount of time to live and have devoted your life to discussions on nature for all time and eternity and have witnessed things that are now and are to become and have been. 11. Most of people are insensible when they rest, and mad when they act. 12. The just person enjoys the greatest peace of mind, while the unjust is full of the utmost disquietude. 13. Among the things accounted just by conventional law, whatever in the needs of mutual association is attested to be useful, is thereby stamped as just, whether or not it be the same for all. And in case any law is made and does not prove suitable to the usefulness of mutual association, then this is no longer just. And should the usefulness which is expressed by the law vary and only for a time correspond with the prior conception, nevertheless for the time being it was just, so long as we do not trouble ourselves about empty words, but look simply at the facts. 14. We have only been born once and will never be born again. We will cease to exist for all eternity. However, despite the fact that you have no control over tomorrow, you are postponing your happiness. Life is wasted by delaying, and each one of us dies without enjoying leisure. 15. We place a high value on our characters as if they were our own possessions, whether or not we are virtuous and praised by other people. So too, we must regard the characters of those around us if they are our friends. 16. Nobody chooses a thing seeing that it is evil. But being lured by it when it appears good in comparison to a greater evil, he is caught. 17. We should not view the young person as happy, but rather the old person whose life has been fortunate. The young person at the height of his powers is often befuddled by chance and driven from his course. But the old person has dropped anchor in old age as in a harbor, since he secures in sure and thankful memory goods for which he was once scarcely confident of. 18. If sight, association, and intercourse are removed, the passion of love is ended. 19. He has become an old person on the day on which he forgot his past blessings. 20. Of our desires some are natural and necessary, others are natural, but not necessary. Others, again, are neither natural nor necessary, but are due to illusory opinion. 21. We must not force nature but persuade her. We shall persuade her if we satisfy the necessary desires and also those bodily desires that do not harm us while sternly rejecting those that are harmful. 22. Unlimited time and limited time afford an equal amount of pleasure, if we measure the limits of that pleasure by reason. 23. Every friendship in itself is to be desired. But the initial cause of friendship is from its advantages. 24. Dreams have neither a divine nature nor a prophetic power, but they are the result of images that impact on us. 25. Poverty, if measured by the natural end, is great wealth. But wealth, if not limited, is great poverty. 26. One must presume that long and short arguments contribute to the same end. 27. The benefits of other activities come only to those who have already become, with great difficulty, complete masters of such pursuits, but in the study of philosophy, pleasure accompanies growing knowledge. For pleasure does not follow learning. Rather, learning and pleasure advance side by side. 28. Those who are overly eager to make friends are not to be approved. Nor yet should you approve those who avoid friendship, for risks must be run for its sake. 29. To speak frankly, as I study nature, I would prefer to speak in oracles that which is of advantage to all people, even though it be understood by none, rather than to conform to popular opinion and thus gain the constant praise that comes from the many. 30. Some people spend their whole life furnishing for themselves the things proper to life without realizing that at our birth each of us was poured a mortal brew to drink. 31. It is possible to provide security against other things, but as far as death is concerned, we people all live in a city without walls. 32. The honor paid to a wise person is itself a great good for those who honor him. 33. The cry of the flesh is not to be hungry, thirsty, or cold. For he who is free of these and is confident of remain so might vie even with Zeus for happiness. 34. We do not so much need the assistance of our friends as we do the confidence of their assistance in need. 35. Don't spoil what you have by desiring what you don't have. But remember that what you now have was once among the things only hoped for. 36. Epicurus's life, when compared to that of other people with respect to gentleness and self-sufficiency, might be thought a mere legend. 37. When confronted by evil, nature is weak, but not when faced with good. For pleasures make it secure, but pains ruin it. 38. He is a very small account for whom there are many good reasons for ending his life. 39. Neither he who is always seeking material aid from his friends nor he who never considers such aid is a true friend. For one engages in petty trade, taking a favor instead of gratitude, and the other deprives himself of hope for the future. 40. He who asserts that everything happens by necessity can hardly find fault with one who denies that everything happens by necessity. By his own theory, this very argument is voiced by necessity. 41. At one and the same time we must philosophize, laugh, and manage our household and other business, while never ceasing to proclaim the words of true philosophy. 42. The same time produces both the beginning of the greatest good and the dissolution of the evil. 43. The love of money, if unjustly gained, is impious, and, if justly, shameful. For it is inappropriate to be miserly even with justice on one's side. 44. The wise person who has become accustomed to necessities knows better how to share with others than how to take from them, so great a treasure of self-sufficiency has he found. 45. The study of nature does not create people who are fond of boasting and chattering or who show off the culture that impresses the many, but rather people who are strong and self-sufficient, and who take pride in their own personal qualities, not in those that depend on external circumstances. 46. Let us completely rid ourselves of our bad habits as if they were evil persons who have done us long and grievous harm. 47. I have anticipated you, fortune, and entrenched myself against all your secret attacks. And we will not give ourselves up as captives to you or to any other circumstance. But when it is time for us to go, spitting contempt on life and on those who here vainly cling to it, we will leave life crying aloud in a glorious triumph song that we have lived well. 48. While we are on the road, we must try to make what is before us better than what is past. When we come to the road's end, we feel a smooth contentment. 49. It would be impossible to banish fear on matters of the highest importance, if a person did not know the nature of the whole universe, but lived in dread of what the legends tell us. Hence, without the study of nature, there was no enjoyment of unmixed pleasures. 50. No pleasure is in itself evil, but the things which produce certain pleasures entail annoyances many times greater than the pleasures themselves. 51. Epicurus, addressing a young man, "I understand from you that your natural disposition is strongly inclined toward sexual passion. Follow your inclination as you will, provided only that you neither violate the laws, disturb well-established customs, harm any of your neighbors, hurt your own body, nor waste your possessions. That you be unaffected by one or more of these conditions is impossible. For a man never gets any good from sexual passion, and he is fortunate if he does not receive harm." 52. Friendship dances around the world, bidding us all to awaken to the recognition of happiness. 53. We must envy no one. For the good do not deserve envy, and is for the bad, the more they prosper, the more they ruin it for themselves. 54. It is not the pretense but the real pursuit of philosophy that is needed. For we do not need the semblance of health but rather true health. 55. We should find solace for misfortune in the happy memory of what has been and in the knowledge that what has been cannot be undone. 56 and 57. The wise person feels no more pain when being tortured himself than when his friend tortured, and will die for him. For if he betrays his friend, his whole life will be confounded by distrust and completely upset. 58. We must free ourselves from the prison of public education and politics. 59. What cannot be satisfied is not a person's stomach, as most people think, but rather the false opinion that the stomach requires unlimited filling. 60. Every person passes out of life as if he had just been born. 61. Most beautiful is the sight of those close to us, when our original contact brings us together or produces a strong desire to this end. 62. If the anger of parents toward their children is justified, it is quite pointless for the children to resist it and to fail to ask forgiveness. If the anger is not justified but is unreasonable, it is foolish for an irrational child to appeal to someone deaf to appeals rather than try to turn it aside in other directions through a display of goodwill. 63. There is also a limit in simple living, and whoever fails to understand this falls into an error as great as that of the person who gives way to extravagance. 64. We should welcome praise from others if it comes unsought, but we should be concerned with healing ourselves. 65. It is pointless for a person to pray to the gods for that which he has the power to obtain by himself. 66. We show our feeling for our friend's suffering, not with laments, but with thoughtful concern. 67. Since the attainment of great wealth can scarcely be accomplished without slavery to crowds or to politicians, a free life cannot obtain much wealth. But such a life already possesses everything in unfailing supply. Should such a life happen to achieve great wealth, this too it can share so as to gain the goodwill of one's neighbors. 68. Nothing is enough to someone for whom what is enough is little. 69. The thankless nature of the soul drives the creature endlessly greedy for variations in its lifestyle. 70. Do not do anything in your life that will cause you to fear if it is discovered by your neighbor. 71. Question each of your desires: what will happen to me if that which this desire seeks is achieved, and what if it is not? 72. There would be no advantage in providing security against our fellow humans, so long as we were alarmed by occurrences over our heads or beneath the earth or in general by whatever happens in the boundless universe. 73. That we have suffered certain bodily pains aids us in preventing others like them. 74. In a philosophical dispute, The one who gains most is the one who is defeated, since he learns the most. 75. The saying, look to the end of a long life, shows small thanks for past good fortune. 76. As you grow old, you are such as I urge you to be, and you have recognized the difference between studying philosophy for yourself and studying it for Greece. I rejoice with you. 77. Liberty is the greatest fruit of self-sufficiency. 78. The noble person is chiefly concerned with wisdom and friendship. Of these, the former is a mortal good, the latter an immortal one. 79. The one who is calm disturbs neither oneself nor another one. 80. The first step toward salvation is to attend to one's youth and guard against that which defiles everything through maddening desires. 81. The soul neither relieves itself of disturbance nor earns a meaningful joy through the possession of greatest wealth, nor by the honor and admiration conferred by the crowd, or through any of the other things pursued by unlimited desire. The end.